the Bible tells us in Exodus chapter 20. And we want to build on the foundation of the second commandment. And verse number 4 says, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. The first point I want you to note right here in verse number 4 and verse number 5, the Bible shows us four generations. Jesus says, I will visit the iniquity of the fathers upon the children. Fathers, children, two generations. Then Christ says, unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. Notice the second point. Verse number 4 and verse number 5. The Bible shows us who will receive this visitation from God, this judgment from God. The Bible tells us these are individuals who worship the image, those who worship falsely. And this second commandment, it has an end time application. So hold your place in Exodus chapter 20, and let's confirm this. In the 13th chapter of the Revelation, the Bible tells us in the 13th chapter of Revelation and verse number 15, the Bible says, and he had power to give life unto the image, that's your word, the image of the beast, that he should both speak and cause, that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And chapter 14, verse number 9, and verse number 10, the Bible tells us, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. So the second commandment deals with an end time scenario. God's people are warned not to worship the image. Go back with me. Hold your place in the book of the Revelation and go back with me now to Exodus chapter 20. And I want you now to notice in verse number 6 that there is a second group highlighted within the second commandment. Verse number 6 says, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. The third point I want you to notice is this. The Bible tells us in verse 4 and verse number 5 that those who worship this image, those who worship falsely, the Bible says that they are going to hate Jesus. Verse number 5 once more. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. So the Bible is telling us the people who live in the third and fourth generations, these individuals are going to hate Jesus. And how will their hatred for Jesus Christ be manifested? Verse number 4, it says they will worship the image. And verse number 6 says, their hatred will be manifested by them disobeying God's Ten Commandments. Verse number 6 once more, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Go back to verse number 6. Let's focus on the second group that we find within the second commandment. Upon whom does the Bible say that Jesus will show mercy? Upon whom? Verse number 6 says, upon thousands. So here is a group delineated as thousands. So now, the fourth thing you want to write down. This group that is called thousands, the Bible says that they are not going to worship falsely. They are not going to worship the image. Verse 6, this group, thousands, This group is in contrast to the group in verse 4 and verse number 5. So which group in verse number 6 is called the thousands who will not worship falsely, will not worship the image. We must compare scripture with scripture so that we will not guess. When you compare Exodus 20, verse 6, verse 4 through verse 6, with chapter 13 of the Revelation and chapter 14 of the Revelation, you will discover this group called thousands represent the group called the 144,000. Hold your place in Exodus chapter 20. Let's confirm this. Go with me in your Bibles. Chapter 13 of the Revelation. Go there with me. The Bible tells us, in verse number 15 of the Revelation, I just quoted that, verse number 15, it says, if we don't worship the image of the beast, Satan, his agents, his human agents, are going to persecute and martyr some of God's people. Verse 16 says, and he caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive that mark of the beast. It says all. That all simply means the majority, because there is a group, the 144,000, who will not bow down and worship falsely. They will not worship the image of the beast. They will not receive the mark of the beast. And to confirm this, chapter 13, verse 15 through verse 18 continues. In chapter 14 and verse number 1, it says, and I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. Now, right down beside chapter 14, verse 1, Exodus chapter 34, verse 6 through verse number 8, go back with me to Exodus chapter 20. The Bible shows us now, Jesus says that he will visit the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate him. Close Exodus 20. Let's build on this premise now. Let's turn our Bibles to Daniel chapter 9. We are going to study the third and fourth generations from the perspective of Christ's earthly ministry. Look with me. Write that down on your note paper. Go with me. Daniel chapter 9. Again, we are studying the third and fourth generation from the perspective of studying, analyzing Christ's earthly ministry. And we will make the application for our last days. Look with me. Daniel chapter 9 and verse number 24 says, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness. And it goes on. Pause right now in verse number 24. So what three things does the Bible say the Jewish people were to bring an end to? Bible says transgression. Note this. Sin. Note that. And the Bible says iniquity. Notice now. The Bible goes on to say that if we, or if the Jewish people, did not bring an end to transgression, sin, and iniquity, that Jesus would visit them, that the Lord would visit the guilty. And bear in mind that this instruction from God to the Jewish people to bring an end to transgression, to sin, and iniquity, it's still present truth. God is calling and instructing me. God is calling and instructing you, Save to Serve International, to bring an end to transgression, sin, and iniquity. And as God said to ancient Israel if you do not bring in everlasting righteousness and cease to commit transgression, sin, and iniquity, I will visit you. God is saying the same, that he will visit me and you. I don't want Christ to visit me. Because when I understand what that word visit means in the context, I don't want Jesus to visit me. Based on that word used in the context, let's begin to study. Hold your place in chapter 9 of Daniel. Let's turn our Bibles to Exodus chapter 34. Go there with me. Exodus chapter 34. We're building on Exodus 20. Jesus says, I will visit the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. Look with me now at Exodus 34. This is what the Bible says. Christ will visit those who refuse to bring an end to transgression, sin, and iniquity. Verse number 6. Skip on down to verse 6. Bible says, and the Lord passed by before Moses and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands. Who does this group represent? The 144,000. Go back to verse 7. Keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. Pause right there. So now, Daniel 9, verse 24, and Exodus 34, verse 6 and verse 7 must be connected. Verse 7, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. Notice now, and that will by no means clear the guilty. What will he do? It says he will visit the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children until the third and fourth generation. And the Bible says in verse 8 that Moses, when he heard those words, he fell down and worshiped God. The experience of Moses must be mine. The experience of Moses must be yours. Go back with me. So what does it mean when the Bible says that Jesus will visit the guilty? Those who refuse to bring an end to transgression, iniquity, and sin. Look with me in your Bibles to Luke chapter 19. Now, remember, we are building on Exodus 20, 4 through verse 6. And Daniel 9, verse 24. Christ told them, the Jewish people, to bring an end to transgression, to sin, and iniquity. The majority, the Jewish nation, did not do so. Did Christ visit them? Yes, not to shake their hands. Christ brought judgment, destruction. Look with me at Luke 19. For what God is saying to me, and to you, Safe to Serve International, if we do not cry out to him for power to not only confess and to repent of our sins, but to bring an end to transgression, sin, and iniquity, Christ will also visit me and you and bring destruction. I do not want Christ to visit me this way. It's destruction. And I'm certain that you, Safe to Serve International, you do not want Jesus to visit you and bring destruction. Look with me. Hold your place in the book of Daniel. Let's turn our Bibles to Luke chapter 19. Look with me here. Luke chapter 19 and verse number 43. It says, the Bible says, for the day shall come, Christ speaking, he says, for the day shall come upon thee, that thine enemies shall cast a trench about thee, and compass thee round, and keep thee in on every side, and shall lay thee even with the ground. That phrase means you are going to die. Many are going to drop dead. And shall leave thee even with the ground, and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another, because thou knewest not the time of what? The time of thy visitation. Did Christ visit them? Did Christ destroy that temple of Jerusalem? Not one stone was left upon another. Those who remained in that city of Jerusalem, were they destroyed in the year AD 70? Yes, they were destroyed. Hold your place in Luke 19. Close everything else. Hold your place in Luke 19. Let's turn our Bibles to Exodus chapter 32. Go there with me. Exodus 32. Look now. Christ says, I'm going to visit those who refuse to bring an end to transgression, to sin and iniquity. That word means to bring destruction. Look with me in your Bibles now to Exodus chapter 32. The Bible tells us in Exodus chapter 32, and look with me how the Bible connects Jesus visiting the guilty, the unrepentant, with the plagues, because they worshipped image, an image. Look with me. Verse number 34, Jesus says, therefore, go back to verse 33. It says, and the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever hath sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. So what is connected to Jesus blotting out names from the book of life? This represents Jesus bringing visitation. Verse 34, therefore now go, lead the people unto the place of which I have spoken unto thee. Behold, mine angel shall go before thee. Nevertheless, in the day when I visit, I will visit their sin upon them. And the Lord did what? And the Lord, the Bible says, plagued the people because they made the calf which Aaron made. The calf was an image of an animal in the forest because they worshiped the image of the beast in the type. Jesus blotted out their names from the book. Jesus, the Bible says, he paid them a visit. He brought the plagues upon them. Is there an application for God's professed people in the last days? Yes. Look with me now. Chapter 14 of the Revelation. Verse number 9 once more. If any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. And what is the wrath of God? It's the seven last plagues specifically, and then destruction. Chapter 15 of the Revelation, verse 1 and verse 2 confirm. And chapter 16 of the Revelation, verse 1 all the way through. This is Jesus bringing visitation. Go back with me now. Close chapter 14. I just made a reference of that. Go with me now to Luke chapter 19. Go back there, my friends. Luke chapter 19. Listen to what Christ says in verse 43. The day shall come. Your enemies are going to come past you around. And verse 44. I want you to understand, friends, listen carefully now. We are addressing the third and the fourth generations. In verse number 44, the Bible uses a specific important pronoun. It says in verse 44, and they shall lay thee, underscore the word thee, and they shall lay thee even with the ground and thy children within thee. So how many generations do we see right here? We see two generations, the parents, the adults, the leaders, and the children, the second generation. Read on. And they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another. Why? Because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. And what does that word visitation mean? It meant judgment in the context. All right. So what generations would the pronoun thee represent in verse 44 and the word children represent in verse 34? Don't guess. Would they represent the first, the second, the third, or the fourth generation? Which one? Don't guess. We must go back to Exodus 20. Go back to Exodus 34. Upon which generations does the Bible say that Jesus will visit and bring judgment? He says, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation that hate me. Underscore this fact, friends. Verse 44, and they shall lay thee. That would represent the third generation in the application for us in the last days. Then the children also would receive Christ, God's visit, God's judgment. They would represent the fourth generation. Notice now, this means when Christ began his earth ministry until he died, Christ ministered to the third generation up until AD 31 when he was crucified on Calvary's cross. Approximately 40 years after the cross, AD 31, bringing us to the year AD 70, the Jewish nation received God's visitation. They received judgment. That means the generation between AD 31 through AD 70 would represent the fourth generation. And some of those people were children in the time period when Christ was born. Somewhere between 4 BC, 3 BC, all the way until he died in the year AD 31. There were children in that generation. Look at the screen right here, my friend. Look at the last two categories. That means Christ's ministry was to the third generation. That's our application. The destruction of Jerusalem was in the fourth generation for our application. Look at the screen. This tells us something, friends. This tells us that the third generation of Christ's ministry would represent generation Y for us, would represent the millennials today. And the destruction of Jerusalem in the fourth generation would represent generation Z today. Now go back with me to Luke chapter 19. Look with me now. Verse number 43. Verse number 44. It was Christ who said, as he was ministering before he died, Christ was speaking to a specific generation. He says, you and your children will receive judgment, a visit. Notice now, that generation, both the third and the fourth, did not know the time of their visitation. In other words, they were not Bible students. In other words, they were not studying correctly, diligently, the prophecies of the Old Testament. The priests, the leaders, the rabbis, the elders, they were not preaching the prophecies of Daniel chapter 8 and Daniel chapter 9. In that chapter of Daniel, chapter 9, we read verse 24. Read on to verse 27. They were not studying the prophecies as a result. Jesus says the third generation and the fourth did not know the time when probation was about to close upon them. Judgment, names in type would be blotted out. Destruction, friends. What is the application for us today? As we today are now living in the time period of generation Y and generation Z, what is the application? The majority of the people in the world and those in the church, they do not know the time of their visitation. That probation is about to close, my friends. Go back with me. Oh, beloved, this is why in verse 41 of Luke 19, what was Christ found doing? Verse 41, it says, when he came near and beheld the city, who were living in the city, his professed people, it says, he wept over it. Why was he weeping, friends? Because the people didn't understand probation was about to close. Even though they had all the opportunities to understand Bible prophecies and to understand the spiritual and the practical work of preparation, what is the application for us? Is Jesus still weeping over the world today, specifically over his professed people? We are living in the third and fourth generations based on the application. Look with me. Close Luke 19. Let's turn our Bibles to Matthew chapter 23. Go there with me. I want to share with you something here. In Matthew 23, Christ made it clear, even though he was speaking to that generation, the third generation, the pronoun thee, that generation, the fathers, the mothers, the leaders, he made it clear that the influences of prior generation, let me say it this way, the apostasies and the heresies that were prevalent among his professed people in prior generations were prevalent in the generation that Christ was ministering to during his earthly ministry. What is the application? The application today is this. Even though, look at the screen, even though the millennials today are people who were born between 1977 based on some record, or 1980 based on others, through 1994, this is the third generation based on the prophetic application. It does not exclude the fact that the apostasies among God's people from the baby boomer generation, 1946 through 1964, are not present and prevalent among God's people in this third and fourth generations. Again, the apostasies and the heresies that were taught in the time period of Generation X between 1965 and 1976, these apostasies and heresies are also present and prevalent among this third and fourth generations. Is that clear, my friends? Look with me. Matthew 23. And look now at verse number 31. It's Christ now who is speaking, and he says, wherefore, you be witnesses unto yourselves. He's talking to the group before AD 31, before his crucifixion, that you are the children of them which killed the prophets. So in the application, Christ is saying to us, the reason why apostasies and heresies are so prevalent among the Seventh-day Adventist denomination and people, it's because we are the offsprings of the sins of generation one and two that we are now experiencing in the third and fourth generations. How influential is the millennials today, the third generation in the application, the Y generation? Look at this, my friend. It says, as we cover this, it says, why the millennials, they are the less religious than older Americans. Look, millennials are the least religious generation yet. And here is the surprising reason why. Let's move on. Washington Post, millennials are significantly more progressive than their parents. Moving on, it says, watch, it says here, the gayest generation, research finds more millennials identifying as LGBT. Look on, it says over 70%. It says, right, look, the Boston Globe, just a few days ago, it says 73% of millennials, all right, are in favor of same-sex marriage. This is the third and fourth generations. Look here, friends, it says, Christian Post, this is May 3rd, 2016. Headline reads, 59% of millennials say Sunday is religiously insignificant. Only 22% of millennials attend church. This study finds that is critical. And so as in the world, so in the church. Look with me in your Bibles. Matthew chapter 23. Notice now. When Christ began his public ministry in AD 27, all the way through his crucifixion, AD 31, that time period is a portion, a segment of the third generation that would lead to the fourth and receive God's visit, God's destruction. Is that point clear? Look now how Jesus described the third generation. Because Christ's description of that generation before the destruction of Jerusalem represent the condition of God's professed people today. I'm not dealing with primarily those in Babylon, those in the world, but those within Seventh-day Adventism. In Matthew 23, and friends, bear in mind, it's in Matthew 24, we know this, that when Christ spoke about his coming and gave signs, most of those signs had a dual application. One, for the literal Jewish nation, and the second, for his professed people and the world in the last days. Matthew 23, look with me, verse 1 through verse number 5. Christ described the third generation before destruction as a generation of leaders, parents, and people who had a form of godliness, but were unconverted. You can read verse 1 all the way down, but focus now on verse 5. It says, but all their works they do to be seen of men. They make broad their phylacteries and enlarge the borders of their garments. Why were they enlarging? Why did they make broader the borders of their garments? You can guess. You must go back to Old Testament scripture and compare scripture with scripture. Write down Numbers chapter 15, verse 37 through verse 41. In that scripture, the Bible says the children of Israel were to put a fringe upon the border of their garment, and that fringe, that ribbon, must be the color of blue. And that color of blue on the border of their garment would represent obedience to God's Ten Commandments. Come back here. Matthew 23, verse 1 through verse 4. Jesus says, they say one thing out of their mouth, but in their lifestyle practices, they do otherwise. They have some things written in their books, their policy books, their manuals, but in action and by word, they do otherwise. They are hypocrites, and this is the condition of God's last day people. Hold your place in Matthew 23. Let's turn our Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. And look with me now at verse number 1, showing, as Christ said, they had a form of godliness, so it is now. Verse 1, this know also, that in the last days, perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, underscore blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures, more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Go back to verse number 2. The Bible mentions the last day people, the professed people of God. The Bible calls them blasphemers. Now notice, Christ himself, when he ministered to that generation just before his crucifixion and just before the destruction of Jerusalem, Christ styled them as blasphemers. Write down Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2, verse 22 through verse 30. In that scripture, Jesus identified a blaspheming people, by this, the following. They call good evil. It leads them to call evil good. And they justify and commend the wicked. In turn, they persecute, crucify, and martyr God's faithful people. This is the condition of the last day church. Go back with me to Matthew chapter 23. Look carefully, friends, how Christ described that third generation before destruction in the fourth is the condition of God's professed people today. Skip on down to verse 6. Verse number 6 shows us that third generation of leaders, professors, pastors, administrators, elders, parents, they were professing and proclaiming false doctrines. They were contaminated with false education. Look with me. Verse number 6 says, Christ now identifying the condition of this generation. Verse 6, and they love the uppermost rooms at feasts and the chief seats in the synagogues and greetings in the markets and to be called of men. What? Rabbi, Rabbi, but be not you called Rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all you are brethren. The Bible is telling us the third generation had established a hierarchical structure. We are rabbis. You better call us rabbis. What does rabbi mean? It means a teacher. It means a master. Listen to this, friends. It says in the book, The Desire of Ages, page 613, it says, Jesus also reproved the vanity shown in coveting the title of rabbi or master. Priests, scribes, and rulers, expounders, and administrators of the law were all brethren, children of one father. Jesus impressed upon the people that they were to give no man a title of honor indicating, watch this, his control of their conscience or their faith. What is the application today? Hold your place in Matthew 23. Look with me at Luke chapter 20. What is the application? That third generation leading into the fourth, the leaders love to be called rabbi and master. What is the application today? Follow me now. And by them coveting the title, you people, you better call us rabbi and master. This title was to show their superiority. And this influence, they used it to compel the conscience of the people to go against God. Today we have now in our seminaries and colleges within Adventism, a degree in theology called a master's degree, doctorate degree. We have master divinity, a master of divinity degree. And now they say we alone, as ministers with our masters of divinity degree, we are the rabbi. Listen what this says one more time. Jesus impressed upon the people that they were to give no man a title of honor, indicating his control of their conscience or their faith. Look with me. Luke chapter 20, my friends. And this shows us that this is a fruit because we have gone to the world to be accredited by them. That degree, doctorate degree, master of divinity. We have now mastered divinity. We have now mastered God. We are above God. And this is why these so-called rabbis, professors, administrators, and ministers within Seventh-day Adventism, they place their own culture, their man-made culture and traditions above the Word of God. Why? They have the title, we are rabbis, we are masters in the church. And one example is in the issue of woman's ordination. Luke 20, look with me. Luke chapter 20, and look with me. At verse number 46, this is linked to Matthew 23, verse 6 to verse 8. It says, beware of the scribes which desire to walk in long robes and love greetings in the markets and the highest seats in the synagogues and the chief rooms at feasts. Is this going on today? Look at it. Look here, friends. There it is. The long robes. If your minister in your church have on similar long robes, that's a problem in the sight of God. Following the world with their papal gowns from paganism. Look at this. There it is, my friends. A pastor within Seventh-day Adventism having on the papal gown. Look with me. Go back with me to Matthew chapter 23. The third and fourth generation. Look how Christ describes this generation. It says in Matthew 23. Verse number 13, but woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, neither suffer you them that are entering to go in. What message has God given to us? Wait a minute, let's back this one up, friends. What message did John the Baptist, the disciples, and Jesus preach specifically? And they all said, this is the message to receive. Accept in your life and live out by God's grace in order to enter into heaven. What was that principal message? Just go back to Matthew 3. Go back to Matthew 10. That word was repent. The time is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. Mark chapter 1. It says, as Christ began preaching, it says, the time is at hand. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. If the kingdom is coming, God is calling for repentance. Go back with me to Matthew 23. So now, what message were those leaders in that generation before the fourth that brought the destruction of the nation of the Jews? What were they rejecting? They were rejecting the messages of Bible repentance. They were rejecting the message of righteousness by faith. Repent and believe the gospel. They were rejecting the principal message of getting victory over sin. So what is the application today? The ministers within Seventh-day Adventism are rejecting these principal messages. Let's connect one more with that. It's the everlasting gospel that we find in chapter 14 of the Revelation. Verse 6 to verse number 16. The three angels' messages, if received, they become the key to unlock heaven's door, and we shall enter into heaven. If that point is clear, my friends, say amen. Look with me. Matthew 23, verse number 14 says, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! Why? You devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayer. Therefore, you shall receive the greater damnation." So how did Jesus describe the third and fourth generation? He says the leaders within the church, they were robbing the people of monies, robbing the people of their property. They devour widows' houses and yet professed that once they receive the monies, the tithes, the offerings, once they received the houses, the land, the properties, that they would use it for God's work. But they were hypocrites. So those who gave their gifts and gave their property to those leaders within the church in that third and fourth generation, they did so ignorantly because Christ called them hypocrites. Look here, friends. It says in The Desire of Ages, page 614, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayer. Therefore, you shall receive the greater damnation." Listen now. The Pharisees had great influence with the people, and of this, they took advantage to serve their own interests. They gained the confidence of pious widows and then represented it as a duty for them to devote their property to religious purposes. Having secured control of their money, the wily schemers use it for their own benefit. To cover their dishonesty, they offered long prayers in public and made a great show of piety. This hypocrisy, Christ declared, would bring them the greater damnation. Is that point clear, my friends? Yes. So this example people use about the woman, the widow, giving her mites to... Let me not go there right now. Look with me. Go back to Matthew 23. So now, are people now signing over their will and their property and their monies to certain church organization? But what are most, not all, what are most of the organizations, the churches, the conference committees, what are they doing with those monies that belong to God, those properties? They are, oh friends, don't get me started. Look with me. It is hypocrisy. They are schemers, and this is the condition of this generation within the third and fourth generation. Someone told me recently that her brother is up in age, older man, and he was about to call this specific ministry within Seventh-day Adventism and to will his property, to sign over, to trust his property to this specific organization. And I'm told, friends, they and I was shown signs and evidences and proofs. They didn't even care for the man's salvation. Their objective, that organization, was to send a lawyer and one of their pastors to the hospital to hold the man's hand, as it were, to sign over his property to that ministry. And as soon as the deed was done, they made a U-turn and left the hospital. Not even a prayer for the man's soul and the man's health and restoration. This is what's going on in the church. If they have no concern for the man's well-being, what will they then do with the money and the property? Friends, probation is about to close. You need to pray, friends. Look with me. Matthew 23. And look with me now at verse number 15. Christ says, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Why? You compass sea and land to make one proselyte, one convert. And when he is made, you make him twofold more the child of hell than yourselves." One thing is clear. That third generation, just before the destruction of Jerusalem in the fourth generation, that group of people, they were active in evangelism. Can you see it? Because Christ mentioned it. But as they baptized souls, as they were bringing souls into the temples and synagogues, what was the condition of those souls? They were just as corrupt and worldly, just as before. What is the application? We have people now saying, look within Seventh-day Adventism. We are baptizing a number of souls. But the question is, what doctrines are being preached? What books are the people studying from? What do they study before baptism? What is the worship lifestyle like and the atmosphere like? Oh yes, friends, that generation represents today. Look at this, friends. Application. Here we have one of these pastors within Adventism keeping a Sunday service. And this pastor, in one interview, he made it clear. The mark of the beast has nothing to do with Sunday when it becomes law. It's just lawlessness. So what would those people receive when they are baptized? And as this Pastor Snell, his name is Pastor Snell, kept his Sunday services, everyone was talking about, look, he baptized a Sunday pastor. Hallelujah. Praise God. But friends, what church atmosphere is that Sunday pastor coming into? What doctrines were he taught? Was the Sunday pastor baptized? Or was he just received with a handshake, what they call a profession of faith? If we must profess our faith, then my friends, we must do so through studying God's present truth and being baptized as a public sign. You have renounced Babylon. When God took Israel from Egypt, they crossed the Red Sea. And the Red Sea represents what? It represents baptism based on 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1 through verse number 4. So those who are coming from Egypt, spiritual Egypt, from Babylon, they must be baptized, my friends. Look what's going on among us. We have this other pastor here within Seventh-day Adventism having this meeting coming up May 7th, 2016. And who is he inviting? Seventh-day Adventist Church in Columbus, Ohio. John Boston inviting Jackie Velasquez, or JC, however it is pronounced. Listen, it says, look at the condition of the church. And they call this evangelism, my friend. Bible says if we are going to sing, 1 Corinthians 14, verse 12 through verse 15, we must sing with the Spirit. And we must sing with the understanding also. If they do not understand the present true doctrine, how can they minister to us in music? they can only spew upon the people an unclean spirit. Look here, friends. We have even Alex Bryan and the One Project Movement inviting Sunday keepers. Look at this. Even this other pastor here, Marquise Johns, May 6th, 2016, inviting a worldly Sunday singer, a worldly preacher to come and stand before Seventh-day Adventists. Let's move on, friends. And who are they following? Their leader, both John Boston and Marquise Johns, they all look up to Cotton Bird from Generation X. John Boston, Marquise Johns, and others belong to the Y and Z generations. And the way how they are now doing what they call evangelism, they are following the directions of Cotton Bird and others from Generation X. The sins from Generation X. Boomer generation is also active today. Yolanda Adams, he is inviting on May 17th. Look at this. Coming up May 28th through June 11th, Spring Revival. Who are they inviting? Worldly musicians, my friends, and worldly pastors. Look at this. Even the pastoral evangelism leadership council every December at Oakwood University, they invite worldly preachers and singers to come and preach. Oh, friends, we are in trouble. Let's take a look here. Matthew chapter 23. Go back there with me. Is this the third and fourth generations? Is probation about to close? Let's skip on down. And what you must understand is this. As I looked at Matthew 23, from verse 1 all the way through, you see a downward progression into damnation. Look now at verse number 29. It's Christ who said, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because you build the tombs of the prophets and garnish the sepulchres of the righteous, and say, if we had been in the days of our fathers, we would not have been partakers with them in the blood of the prophets. Wherefore you be witnesses unto yourselves that you are the children of them which killed the prophets. Fill you up then the measure of your fathers, you serpents, you generation of vipers. How can you escape the damnation of hell?" What generation did Christ say would not escape the damnation of hell? It was the third generation, the adults, and the children of the fourth generation. What is the application today, my friends? It's very, very clear. And what was that last sin? As Christ described the third generation, he says, you build up the tombs of the prophets. And you say, oh, if we had lived in prior generations, we would have accepted the prophets. But Jesus says, you are the children of them that reject the prophets, and you will be lost as a result. Can we find an application today? Look at this, my friends. In 2004, 2005, the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists voted this. It says, Sister White can enrich but not define our faith and practice. Let's move on. And the General Conference president, the former N.C.Wilson, stated, the three angels' messages belong to the historical trash heap of Seventh-day Adventism. We are in trouble, my friend. And in 2000, the present administration in 2000 stated The book Great Controversy belongs in the trash. Here we are, friends. And in 2015, the General Conference in session stated and removed. On top, you see the following words. That Sister White was the Lord's messenger. Her writings are a continuous and authoritative source of truth. But then they voted that her writings speak only with prophetic authority and provide comfort, guidance, and instruction and correction to the church. What did they remove? That she is the Lord's messenger and her writings speak continually with authoritative power. Oh, friends, we are in trouble as a church. And what is now the fruit of generation Y and Z, X and the baby boomer generation rejecting God's present truth? Now we have pastors and people rejecting the three angels' messages. Look at this. This is one Kirtley Knight, a former SDA pastor, saying he no longer believes in the writings of Ellen G. White. And he left the Seventh-day Adventist movement. I wonder what his brother, Wesley Knight, is going to do next. His older brother. Watch this, friends. Here we have him saying, and listen to what Kirtland Knight said in this interview. He says, watch carefully. He says, I no longer believe in the Sabbath. The Sabbath is not important for salvation. In other words, he has rejected the fact we must obey God's Ten Commandments. Does he fall in the third and fourth generation based on Exodus 20 verse 4 through verse number 6? I'm not saying he's lost, but if he doesn't change and others, they are all going to be lost. He says, next sentence, he says, I know many Seventh-day Adventist pastors who have fundamental theological differences with the pillars of Adventism. They no longer believe in the Sabbath, the sanctuary, investigative judgment, the spirit of prophecy, and the state of the dead. Look at one more. Here he is. The most recent, Elsie Lauriston, or Else Lauriston. People are leaving the faith. What's going on? Probation's hour is fast closing. Look with me. Judges chapter 7. Go there with me, my friends. Judges chapter 7. We are now living in what generation? The third and fourth. Probation is about to close. It's time for us then to bring an end to transgression, sin, iniquity, or else Jesus is going to visit me and you. Probation is going to close. My name, your names will be blotted out of the book of life if we do not bring an end to sin in our lives. Judges chapter 7. Pardon me. Judges chapter 17. Look with me here at verse number 6. This is the condition of the church today. Verse 6 says, in those days, there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Go back with me now to Matthew chapter 23. Go back there with me. Matthew chapter 23. When Christ described the condition of the third generation before the fourth generation, when Christ said that the last step is to reject the writings of his messengers and the present one, Ellen G. White, her writings, he says now, your house is left unto you desolate. What is God saying now to most Seventh-day Adventists? Your house is about to be overthrown. Am I ready? Are you ready? Probation's hour is about to close. Not only did Christ minister to that third generation before the fourth generation that saw the destruction of Jerusalem, but note this, John the Baptist also preached and ministered to that third generation. Look with me, Matthew chapter 3. And look now, what did John say to that third generation? Because the mindset of that third generation is the mindset of this last generation before probation closes. John the Baptist said, you must repent of your sins. John the Baptist said, think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father, because God is able to raise up children of these stones, to raise up children unto Abraham. So what was John saying in Matthew chapter 3, verse 5 through verse number 9? What was John saying? John the Baptist shows us something. The condition of that generation was, we are God's people. We are Abraham's children. We are going to be saved by default. But John the Baptist told them, your name, the name you profess, cannot save you. That's it, friend. Have you ever heard such things today? Many folks say, we are Seventh-day Adventists. We will never be lost. What happened to that generation? Were they overthrown? Did God raise up other children to take their place? My Lord, have mercy upon your people. Have mercy upon me. Have mercy upon Seventh-day Adventists. Hold your place in Matthew chapter 3. Let's turn our Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 7. Go there with me. Jeremiah chapter 7. Look carefully, friends. In the 7th chapter of Jeremiah, note these verses. Verse 3 through verse number 16. Jeremiah 7, verse 3 through verse number 16. The Bible says that Jeremiah said to that generation, he said, don't think your name can save you. Can't save you. Jeremiah says, you are trusting in a lie. And the lie was, they were saying, we are God's temple. We are God's temple. We are God's temple. In other words, they were saying, we are God's church. And Jeremiah says, you are trusting in a lie. How could you profess to be God's temple, God's church, and yet you are burning incense unto Baal? That's verse number 9. Friends, what does Baal worship represent for us? It is Sunday worship. It's paganism. It's pagan worship. Our professed Adventists, people and leaders, inviting, adopting the false doctrines of Babylon. And they think just because their names are chronicled on the books of a church, that will save them while they continue in apostasy. Look now. God then says to Jeremiah in verse number 14 through verse number 16, God says, beginning in verse number 12 through verse 16, as I did to Shiloh, I will do to this generation. What did God do to Shiloh? God destroyed Shiloh. And who were the leaders of Shiloh? We have Eli, Hophni, and Phinehas. And what were Hophni and Phinehas doing in the church? Apostasies. And yet they thought they would be saved and preserved, but God cut them down. And that history was repeated in the days of Jeremiah. So what will happen now in these last days? And God told Jeremiah in verse number 16, don't even pray to me on their behalf, because I will not hear your prayers. Their probation is about to be closed. Don't even pray for them. I wonder what God is saying to us as we look at the majority of Seventh-day Adventists who are mingling in gross apostasy. What is God saying to us as he said to Jeremiah? Is God saying to us, stop praying for them? I don't know, friends. I don't know. It's time for me and you to seek God in prayer. Is there still hope for your people? Look with me at Jeremiah. Verse number 11. God said through Jeremiah, is this house, which is called by my name, become a den of robbers in your eyes? Did Christ use similar words? Close Jeremiah 7. Let's turn our Bibles to Luke chapter 19. Did Christ use similar words, my friends? Yes, he did. Christ said in Luke 19, verse 41 through verse number 48, Jesus says, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. When Christ made that statement, it's in connection with Jesus visiting them with judgment. Since the same sins are applicable and prevalent right now, is probation about to close? Again, did John the Baptist preach to that third generation? Yes. The third. So God now, listen, Save to Serve International. So God now must raise up ministers, missionaries, ministries, self-supporting churches, like John the Baptist, the disciples, and Jesus. Why? Because all of these men ministered to the third generation as true self-supporting ministers before the destruction of Jerusalem. So God now must raise up such ministries today. Would you say amen, my friends? Yes. And what was the stated mission of John the Baptist? Hold your place in Luke 19. What was the mission of John the Baptist? You want to write down these scriptures, please, friends. Malachi chapter 4, verse 4 through verse 6. And the Bible says, before the great and dreadful day of the Lord, I will send you Elijah. And what was the work of Elijah? It says he would turn the hearts of the children to the fathers. Can you see it, my friend? And who came in the spirit and power of Elijah? It was John the Baptist. Write down Luke chapter 1, verse 13 through verse number 17 and 18. And the Bible says John's mission was to turn the heart of the children to the fathers, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just. That means John the Baptist, his ministry to that third generation of adults, and the fourth generation of children was to turn their hearts back to the true principles of God. What is my mission? What is your mission? We must turn back to God. And we must proclaim messages that would turn the third generation, the fourth generation, the final class of people back to the principles of truth of our founding fathers, the pioneers of Seventh-day Adventism. Is that point clear? Let's turn our Bibles now. Close Luke 19. Close everything. Let's go now to John chapter 8. Listen to what Christ says in John chapter 8. Note these verses. John chapter 8, verse 35 through verse 39. Christ said to that third generation, he says, I know that you are Abraham's seed, but you are not Abraham's children. If you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. You would accept me. And verse 44, Jesus says of John 8, 44, you are of your father, the devil. So whose children were those individuals in that third generation before the close of probation. They were the children of the devil. This is why Christ called them a generation of vipers. What is the application today? Can someone talk to me? Whose children are we? Well, friends, I want to be a child of God, Saved to Serve International. Whose children do you want to be? Look at Matthew chapter 8, my friends. That means the majority of those within Seventh-day Adventism, even though they have a connection to the church, a movement, even though they can say, as did those Jews, we are Abraham's seed, the offspring of a movement, God's true movement. But are they God's children? All right, friends. Go with me. Matthew chapter 8. Friends, these are the messages that keep me on my knees in prayer, in self-examination. Because when Christ spoke to that generation, Jesus said, you are all going to be lost. And others from the world, the Gentile world, will come and take your place. What is God saying to us? Matthew chapter 8, look with me. Verse number 10. Speaking of that centurion, Christ says, verily, verily, I say unto you, I have not found so great faith. No, not in Israel. And I say unto you that many shall come from the east and west and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in where? In the kingdom of God. Oh, friends, listen, verse 12. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Look with me. Luke chapter 17. Friends, in Luke chapter 17, again, both Jesus and John the Baptist ministered to that third generation before probation closed. Is that point clear? Understand this. Christ spoke to that third generation. Again, a mixture of previous generations. Remember, this can be confirmed looking at Annas and Caiaphas. One was younger, the other older. Christ ministered in the time period when you find generations of people together. Is that point clear, friends? And Christ said that third generation, just before the destruction of Jerusalem, would reject John the Baptist and himself. Look at this, Luke 17. So friends, was John the forerunner? Luke 17. And look with me at verse number, just mark these verses. Luke chapter 17. And look with me here in verse number, let's begin here with verse number 13. Luke 17 and verse number 13. The application is, write this quote down in the book Early Writings, page 258. We are told these words, that as John the Baptist was rejected, they also rejected Jesus. And listen now, then we are told, because they rejected John the Baptist and Jesus, they did not receive the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. They missed the early rain. Three, look at this today. Then inspiration says, in Early Writings, page 258 and 259, as they rejected John the Baptist and Jesus, God's people in the last days will reject the first angel's message, the second angel's message, and the third. As a result, they would not receive the outpouring of the latter rain. Oh, friends, close Luke 17. Look with me. Luke chapter 7. Go there with me. Luke chapter 7. Can you see it, my friends? Go back and read these quotations. Luke chapter 7. And how many pastors today have rejected the principles of the first angel's message? In application, they have rejected John the Baptist. They have rejected health reform. That's in the first angel's message. Dress reform. That's it, friends. They have rejected true Sabbath keeping. Many attend church on the Sabbath. And as soon as the midday service is over, they tell their family members and they go to the restaurants in the world, friends. Olive Garden, you name it. On the Sabbath, the services in the church is breaking God's true principles of Sabbath keeping. Many have rejected the sanctuary message, not only in theory, the truth, but also in experience, getting victory over sin. Many have rejected the second angel's message, which points to the fall of Babylon. It's falling. How do we know that? If they are borrowing, using, reading, studying, and giving to their members and family members the books, the sermons from infidel authors and preachers, they have rejected the second angel's message. If they are now aligned with Babylonian institutions, they have rejected the second angel's message. This is why they are also in a fallen spiritual condition. Luke chapter 7, look here carefully. Mark these verses. Verse number 31. And the Lord said, whereunto then shall I liken the men of this generation? And to what are they like? Verse 32 through verse 35. Jesus says, John the Baptist came preaching. Not eating, not drinking. You said John had a devil. The Son of Man came eating and drinking. You all said he is a wine bibber. He is a glutton. They rejected John and Jesus. What is the condition of God's professed people today? They have rejected the Bible's principles and the principles we find in the spirit of prophecy, the writings of Ellen G. White. Probation is about to close. Hear me. Because Jesus knew that probation was about to close. And that generation he was talking to, hear me, the leaders, administrators, the priests, the elders, the parents, they were a wicked and evil generation. Hear me. We find Jesus ministering to the children. Wow. In that generation. Why? Because left to the leaders, those children would be corrupt. Look with me. Matthew chapter 19. So what is Christ saying? What is Christ saying should be our work right now as we realize that the leaders are in apostasy? What is Christ saying should be our work in these last days? Jesus now is saying we should be ministering to the children. Why, friends? Because in the type, when the destruction of Jerusalem came, in that fourth generation, children were overthrown. Children were lost. Jesus began to minister to children. This must be our work. Matthew chapter 19. Know these verses. Verse 13. Verse 14. Even the disciples did not get it. They were trying to keep away the children from coming to Jesus. But Christ said, no, no, no. Suffer them. Allow them to come unto me. Bring them to me. Why? The priest and leaders and parents, they were in gross apostasy. Bring the children to me. So God must raise up ministries ministers, true self-supporting ministers, parents who will gather the children in their homes under their wings, educate them in the theory of present truth, educate them in the spiritual, practical experience of victory over sin. Yes, so they would not be overthrown, but be saved by God. Look now at the fruit of Christ's ministry with the children in that wicked generation. Go to Matthew 21. Do you remember Christ said to that generation, it's an evil one. It seeks for a sign. Yet the sign that God gave to them, the sign of prophecy, the sign of preparation, they rejected that sign and kept on asking, show us more signs. It's an evil generation. What's the application today? Seventh-day Adventist, the majority, not all, the majority, they refuse to identify and see the signs, the current events fulfilling Bible prophecy, both within the world and in the church, and keep on saying, where are the signs that probation is about to close? They are an evil group of people. Look with me. Matthew 21, it says in verse number 14 onward, who were the ones preaching when those elders, when Christ's disciples, when the people were told not to preach the truth, who were the ones preaching? It was the children. Look with me, friends. So now it says in verse 15, it says, and when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that Jesus did, and the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. The leaders, chief priests, they were sore displeased and said unto him, hearest thou what we say? And Jesus saith unto them, yea, have you never read out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, thou hast perfected praise? Friends, think about this. What were the attitude of those chief priests when those children began to preach present truth? They were sore displeased. Do you think those chief priests were in apostasy? They allowed those children to continue to preach? No, friends. After a time, they would try every means to silence them or disfellowship them or excommunicate them. What is the application today? That means Jesus must raise up churches, ministries that will house the children, educate them theoretically and spiritually, that they can be ready to give the present truth messages in this closing moments of earth's history, fulfilling Matthew 21 verse 16 and Psalm 8. Question for you, my friends. Do you think children only mean those who are young in age? No. Children also mean those who were young in the faith. They were babes in the faith. Look with me. John chapter 11. Where are we going to now? John chapter 11. We are closing now. In John chapter 11, we see Christ about to be crucified. Which generation declared that Jesus must die? It was the third generation. Who were the leaders in the third generation? The priests, the rabbis, Caiaphas, Annas. Wait a minute now, friend. What is the application? The third generation represents generation Y. In this generation, we have people who were born in the time period of 1977 and onward. They are the ones, the movers and the shakers within Seventh-day Adventism, not excluding others from Generation X and the baby boomer generation. That means these are the individuals who will mandate, declare that those today who are preaching and doing a similar work as Jesus did must be stopped, must be silenced. Go to John chapter 11, friends. You must see this. Was Christ healing? Yes. And healing represents restoration of body, mind, and soul. Would you say amen? That's my work. That's your work. Then it says in verse number 48, if we let this man alone, all men will believe on him. And the Romans shall come and take away both our place and nation. That word place, it means position. It means your popularity. That word nation represents their structure. That means the generation X and Y and the baby boomer generation. They will magnify and uplift. We want to preserve our popularity in the world. In the church, we want to preserve the structure of Seventh-day Adventism, the conferences, the schools, the hospitals. And they will say and do this at the expense of rejecting God's present truth, maligning the characters of God's present truth preachers, even marginalizing God's end time preachers. That's it, my friends. Close John chapter 11. Let's go in our Bibles to Matthew 27. And hear me carefully. Write down selected messages, book 1, page 204 and 205. We are told when the storm approaches, when the Sunday law hits, it comes in a time when there is a new organization. And inspiration says that storm and tempest will sweep away the structure. Why? The structure is built upon sand. So all those who are saying, let's preserve the conferences. I want to tell you something, friends. They would do this. Let's preserve it at the expense of rejecting present truth. But storm and tempest, we are told, will sweep away the structure. So I'm sorry for those who reject present truth and remain in the apostate churches saying, stay on the ship. They don't know what a ship is. They have missed it, my friends. Stay in the church. They don't know what a church is. They're ignorant. Matthew 27. Look carefully here, friends. Oh, I wish I could go deeper. Matthew 27. Jesus is about to die. He knows it. And this third generation, the leaders were the ones who said to Pilate, crucify Jesus. Give us Barabbas. The leaders of the third generation persuaded the Jewish people to say, we do not want Jesus. Crucify him. Give us Barabbas. That's Matthew 27, verse 16 through verse 23. So what is the application? What will generation Y and X and the baby boomer generation say and do? They will persuade Seventh-day Adventists to reject Jesus, reject present truth, and accept a lie, accept Satan, accept popery, accept the Antichrist, because Barabbas was in type the Antichrist. Barabbas, the son, Barabbas, son of Abba, son of the father, Barabbas. Bar, son of Abba, father, Barabbas, the son of the father. They will reject God's truth. Look at verse 25. It says, do you see why, friends, we must plead for God's people, plead for ourselves? Verse 25 says, then answered all the people and said, his blood be on us and on our children. Wait a minute there. How many generations saved to serve? How many do we see right here? We see two generations. They said, his blood be on us and on our children. Now, Jesus says, I'm going to visit the iniquity on the of the father upon the children to the third and fourth. That means this confirms again that Jesus was ministering to the third generation. For they said, his blood be on us, parents, leaders, and on our children. And listen, we are told in The Desire of Ages, page 739, we are told, oh friends, we are told that judgment was handed down upon those children and those who were alive from the X generation and the Y generation. Listen carefully what this says. It says, looking upon the smitten Lamb of God, the Jews had cried, his blood be on us and on our children. That awful cry ascended to the throne of God. That sentence pronounced upon themselves was written in heaven. That prayer was heard. The blood of the Son of God was upon their children, a perpetual curse. Terribly was it realized in the destruction of Jerusalem, the third and the fourth generations. Can you see it, my friends? I'm not finished yet. God's Spirit is not through with us. Go to John 19 with me. Where we're going to, my friends, the sad reality is in John chapter 19, it was the third generation. In the application, boomers, X and Y generations. It was that generation that said, listen, we don't want Christ. Crucify him. Give us Barabbas. And when Pilate seemed he would not give in, the Jewish leader said, in response to Pilate, behold your king. They said, we have no king, Pilate. We have no king but Caesar. So that generation said, we are willing to join with Caesar to kill Jesus. Lord, have mercy upon our souls. My Lord, my Lord. Lord, have mercy upon our souls, my friends. They were willing to say, Caesar is our king. The third generation to destroy Jesus. And what was shocking is this. The Jewish people did not like the Roman army. They detested the Roman government because they were being oppressed by Rome. But in order to get rid of present truth, to get rid of Jesus, to get rid of Bible truth, they said, we are willing to unite with the state, church and state, to destroy Jesus. The third generation did that. Don't be surprised if the men who are now influential from the baby boomer generation, the X generation, the Y generation, begin to bring some of us to court, trying to stop and silence us. Why? Because we are presenting present truth. Jesus says, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they rejected me, they will reject you. So who will Seventh-day Adventists, those apostates, join with? They will join with the papacy. They will join with the states, the civil government of all nations, to stop and to silence present truth. It's coming, my friends. Just mark that. John chapter 19, verse 14 through verse 15. Close that. Look with me. Luke 23. We close right here. Luke 23. And look with me at verse number 27, friends. And listen, you can write down the great controversy, page 605 to 608. We are told God, go back to page 608 primarily. GC, the great controversy, page 608. We are told our former brethren, when we are called to the courts, they are going to testify against us. We have no king but Caesar. Luke 23. Look with me at verse 27. It says here, Jesus is about to be crucified. And as he's carrying the cross, weeping in agony, it says there were some women lamenting and weeping for him. And Christ stopped and turned into their direction and looked squarely in their eyes. And what did Christ say in verse 28 of Luke 23? Daughters of Jerusalem, weep not for me, but weep for yourselves and your children. For behold, the days are coming into which they shall say, blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bear, and the paps which never gave suck. How many generations do we find in verse 28? Weep not for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children, because your children will receive that visitation. And those of you who are alive then will also receive that visitation, because you refuse to bring an end to transgression, sin, and iniquity. We see two generations, which would represent again the third and the fourth generations. Don't even weep for me. You better weep for yourselves. Weep for your children. We have to examine ourselves now, my friends. What is Christ saying to me? What is Christ saying to you? Don't even weep for me. You better weep for yourselves. Weep for your children. So Christ is saying it's time for us to have godly sorrow for sin. Affliction of soul. It's time to weep for the church. Oh, my friends, this must be my experience. This must be your experience. It must be our experience before Jesus visits. Hear me now as I close. That visit doesn't only represent destruction, because he also visits to call us to repentance and to give us victory over sin. Psalm 8 says, Psalm 8, verse 1 through verse 8, what is man? What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? That's it, friends. Thou hast made him a little lower than the angels. Crown him with glory and honor, and have put all things under his feet. That's the most important visitation that we want. Christ paying us a visit. Christ knocking on our doors. I want that visitation, not the second, which brings destruction. So if I reject the first visitation of love and truth, then he will visit with the plagues and destruction. Which visitation do you want, Save to Serve International? Father in heaven, this evening, you spoke to all of us. We surrender anew. Revive, reform, convict, convert our hearts. The last words were, weep not for me, weep for your children, and weep for yourselves. Dear God, help us even now to examine ourselves. Take these words to heart. Save us, we pray. And as we go forward now, help us to prepare others for the close of probation and for your soon return. Bless Save to Serve International, that we will be found weeping for ourselves, weeping for our children in the spiritual sense. Save us, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.